session two. So having given you some background about depression and the brain and serotonin, I want to give you some tips now of how to help you with your depression, or even how to prevent it. You know, there are people who've survived terrible tragedies, terrible disasters, war, famine, floods, other such things, and terrible hardships without getting depressed. I bet you all know or can think of people like that who've come through horrible times. And this is what seems to be the reason that they found that that happens for those people, is that it's not the circumstances of life that lead you to depression. Because we all have circumstances. I was just talking to a few people in the coffee break, and so many people here have had bad stuff happen. But it's not the circumstances as such, it's how you, can you guess? How do you deal with it, how you think about it, how you respond. If you want to write anything down, write that word, respond. How do you respond to what life throws at you? Because human resilience is actually a very awe-inspiring quality. I'm going to show you a photo of a guy. Who knows who this guy is? His name is Nick Vujicic. Is that right? Nick Vujicic. But actually, he's a little bit more complicated than that. I thought my name was hard enough. Anyway, this is a guy who, if you don't know, he was born with this very rare condition where he doesn't have any limbs. He's born in 1982, so that makes him... Who's good at maths? 33. And he says that as a child, he obviously struggled mentally, emotionally with his condition. He had thoughts of suicide, but eventually he came to terms with the disability, and at the age of 17, started his own non-profit organization called Life Without Limbs. And what he does is he goes around the world giving motivational speeches on finding hope and finding meaning in life. And actually, do you know what is the reason for how he found victory over his struggles? He became a Christian. And he talks about his passion for God, his passion for life. And now he's got a baby, I think some of you have seen. So it's you know, life's really turned around for him. And he's never lost the hope that God can still heal him. Apparently he has a pair of shoes in his cupboard. Just believing and just trusting God, but left it to God in a sense. So there's something in all of us that is able to overcome even the hardest of situations. And I'm just going to share with you just a couple of tendencies that tend to distinguish people who get depressed from those who cannot. And by the way, this is where a really good counselor can help you. So I'm all for counseling as well, as long as it's a good type of counseling, which I'll just tell you right now, what I disagree with, and this is based on science, is the type of counseling that makes you tell your story, your sad story, over and over and over and over again. Saying it once or twice, yes, you have to do it to share where you've come from. But the counselor will then help you to view that event in your life with a different pair of eyes, as it were, to view it in the context of, well, that was your past, but this is your future. And the reason that is not good to rehash your past is actually this. As far as your brain is concerned, if you right now tell a story in your past, and you tell it with all the emotion and all the things that went on, and this person said this, and that person said that, and this is how I felt. Do you know what? Your brain thinks it's happening right now. So can you guess what's happening? It's releasing chemicals of stress, anxiety, fear, trauma, whatever you felt then. Your brain thinks it's happening now. So can you see why I'm saying that? So there are different types of therapies, and you know, a good counselor can guide you to what is best for you. But I'll just say that to throw that in, that if you find that you're having to tell your story more than a few times, it's time to find another counselor. Okay, so these are the tendencies that distinguish people who get depressed from those who do not. The ones who get depressed tend to have this what we call black and white, all or nothing type of thinking. So, for an example, suppose you woke up late one morning. Black and white thinking says, oh my God, I've overslept. I can't go to work. My day's ruined. What is a good type of thinking is, oh, I've overslept. I'll phone in, I'll say, I'm so sorry, I have overslept, I'm really sorry, I'll try not to do it again, I'll get a proper alarm clock, I will be delayed, and here's another plan for the day. Okay? Another one is, you pass, you're at work or you're at church, you're walking along, and the pastor walks right past you. He doesn't smile at you, doesn't even acknowledge you. Black and white thinking. He didn't smile at me today. He obviously doesn't like me anymore. He doesn't appreciate this flock, does he? The normal type of thinking, the rational thinking is, gosh, he must be frightfully busy. I wonder what's wrong. He seems very preoccupied. I wonder if I should go and ask, can I help him? Oh, that's what's happening. The toilet's leaking. He's poor guy's trying to fix it and needs certain tools. Can you see different types of thinking? And the thing is, you can train yourself. Don't say, oh, that's the way I was born, I'm always going to have black and white thinking. You can train yourself or get someone to help you. And the reason is this, it's interesting for you to know, important for you to know, why does the human mind do this? It's because within our brain, we've actually got more than one type of brain. So to keep it very simple, we have an emotional brain, called the amygdala, if you want to Google that, A-M-Y-G-D-A-L-A. And we've got the rational mind. So the emotional mind, the rational mind. The rational mind is the prefrontal cortex. Normally, as you're going through life, you're chugging along, you need both. So here's an example. You're walking down the road. Maybe it's a little bit dark. And you're walking on the street. And then there's some bushes on this side. And then there's a bit of a rustling. And you see something black in the corner of your eye moving in the bushes. Now, if you're a woman, particularly, you might think, first thought that comes in your mind is not a good thought, right? Something's hiding in the bush. Or if you lived in Canada, your first thought is, oh my God, it's the grizzly bear. Okay? And what that does, it sets off in you, just that thought in a nanosecond sets off in you the ability to fight that beast, fight that guy, or run for all your life, and you can run faster than you ever thought possible because something set off in you. But almost at the same time, the rational brain, so the emotional brain sees the threat, decides what to do. The rational brain also kicks in and makes you think, hang on, analyze, what is it? What is it? Quick. Oh, it's just a bin liner. Like a bin liner caught in the hedge. Oh, it's okay, carry on walking. So that settles you down. But the problem is that in some people, the emotional brain tries to hijack the rational brain and it runs all the time or most of the time. So you're always in this emotional kind of black and white, fight or flight kind of thinking. And this is a very important thing for you to know. We think, most people think that depression is a condition without emotions, where your brain is just flat. I'm depressed. Everything's flat. Actually, it's not the case at all. When you're depressed, your emotions are running very high. Your brain, emotional brain is switched on full, and strong feelings and thoughts are running around, and so are stress hormones. And this is going to be very important a bit later on when I explain a remedy for depression. It's because of that, the fact that emotional brain is full. So one type of thinking that's not good is black and white thinking. The other type of thinking is one that's focused always on the negatives. Have you met people like that? Are you like that? Yeah? So in a way, like as I said before, you always focus on, well, what is that person doing for me? How come they didn't say that? How come so-and-so hasn't rung me up? I've been out of church for 3 weeks. Not a single person's rung me up. They obviously don't care. Huh, I'll need to find another church. what negative focus does is actually makes you very self-centered, because you are the object of your focus. So for example, if you just take a fist, clench your fist, imagine you're standing right by the sea, beautiful sea, lovely blue water, the sun is shining. Now take this fist and just bring it to the front of your face and look at your fist in such a way that it's blocking out everything around you. Can you see? Is the sea still there? Yes. Everything's still there, but your focus is on you, your problems, how life has treated you. And so people who tend to get depressed often have that type of negative thinking, negative focus. Okay? And this is, again, counseling. A good counselor, as they're hearing you, will sense that about you, and they'll give you strategies to change that. It can be changed. And here's a graph, picture. I want to show you that depression is a sort of a cycle. Okay? So let's start with the top, at the top. So you all heard that when people are depressed, they often find it hard to go to sleep and they wake up early. So they wake up exhausted. Then they go on to worry about the fact that they're tired and how are they going to cope and how are they going to do this? Will they have enough energy? Then this leads them to worrying about life in general. This life sucks, you know. Not getting anything that I want. None of my dreams are coming through. Then they worry about what would happen if my dreams don't come through. If I don't get that business going, if I don't earn enough money, how are my children going to survive? How am I going to manage? And this affects your sleep back again, because often you're worrying in your sleep and you again wake up exhausted. Can you see there's a cycle? And here's another interesting piece of scientific research, that when a depressed person is sleeping, normally when any of us who don't have depression, when we're sleeping, most of the time is spent in resting sleep. And just about a quarter of the time is spent in REM, R-E-M. Have you heard of R-E-M sleep? It's when your eyes are fluttering. That's when the person's normally dreaming. And what they've found is that in the dream, in your dream state, you're resolving issues in your mind. Somehow your brain is resolving stuff that was unresolved the previous day. But when people are depressed, they have much more dreaming, much more of the intense dreaming, which is very exhausting for the body because it uses up a lot of energy, and less of the restive sleep. And the reason is this, because they worried, and the cycle showed you, they worried a lot in the day before, what the brain is doing in the night is trying to resolve those worries. So the more you worry during the waking hours, the more work your brain has to do at night. So can you see? That's why you wake up exhausted. So what do you think would be the remedy to having a good sleep is if we can find a way to help people with their worries. Yeah? Which is why the scientists and psychologists are saying help people to unravel issues of life, their depression will lift. Okay. Now I'm going to today teach you some non-drug ways. I agree with drugs, I said to you earlier, I agree with medication, sometimes you just need that help. But there are also some non-drug ways to help your brain to grow, to stave off depression. And well done for coming today, because you're going to get a little gift. And my husband, Ravi, and my daughter, Angie, are going to distribute a little gift to each of you. So I just wait a few minutes for each of you to get that. For those of you who've got this must be thinking, what the heck? Why have I got a present for my child? Okay, what you all, what have you all got? It's Play-Doh. Okay? And a little penny on the top. That's funny. So I want you to feel free to open the lid, take out the Play-Doh, squeeze it, feel it, make some shapes with it. Oh dear. Now, why am I giving you Play-Doh? This is why. The brain has got a quality about it called neuroplasticity. Has anyone, who has heard of that word before? About a half of you, right? Now, neuroplasticity is a big word, and it's talking about the brain. Now, plasticity, it doesn't mean the brain is plastic, like the tub. Plasticity means it's malleable, moldable. So can you see, as you're all massaging and squeezing your Play-Doh, that's just like your brain. Your brain can be changed, can be molded, can be pressed. So I just want you to understand that your brain is maybe not quite what you thought. It's not a fixed structure in the brain. It's not just what it is and that's it, I can never change it. It can be completely changed, and you're going to learn how today. You see, the brain, oh actually, I've got a brain somewhere. I know I have a brain. If you're interested, we have a model of the brain, the actual size. So it's just a jelly-like structure. Ravi's just going to hold that up. And that's all it is. It doesn't look that impressive. It's like a gray thing. But this amazing thing was what was behind that wonderful bridge that we crossed over today. This, in the minds of certain engineers and architects, built that incredible bridge. What's the name of the bridge? Seven Bridge, and all those special poles. Your mind is the most amazing creation of God. And not only that, God has put in it certain qualities that science is only just finding out about, but God has been telling us all along. Okay? So this is what I want you to do. I want you to take that coin now, take it off the lid. Because see, your brain has been wired a certain way based on how you were brought up, what you were taught at school, what you were told by your parents. Your parents may have said to you, you're a wonderful person, I believe in you, go, you know, go girl, do well, I'm sure do well in life. Or they may have said, you stupid fool, shut up, keep quiet, you're a load of rubbish. Whatever you heard growing up, whatever beliefs you had, has wired your brain a certain way. Now when I say wired, it's not like these wires. That's like hard and firm and can't be broken. Imagine cobwebs. Imagine cobwebs in your brain. They're there, but they're quite fragile. But you can easily undo a cobweb, can't you? And the spider would build another cobweb quickly. Well, think of that as the quality of your brain. It can be changed. So, I want you to make the shape of a brain with your Play-Doh. And Ravi may come around and judge who's got the best Play-Doh brain. But this is what I want to show you, what neuroplasticity means. Take the coin and I want you to press it gently every time I say something to you, okay? Now, don't take this personally. I'm going to tell you certain things. Okay. Yeah, so can you just... So, every time I say something, press gently, just gently with the coin. Okay, here we go. You're stupid. You're rubbish. You'll never amount to anything. I don't know why you were born. Nobody cares about you. What does your little brain look like? Squashed. It's called imprints. Okay. Do those imprints just bounce back? Do they just disappear? No. They're there. Now let's try something different. Okay. So keep it as it is. Now turn your coin to a different angle so it looks different. Now I'm going to tell you something else. You're wonderfully made. Press it in. God has a plan for your life. God loves you. You are special. You are unique. Now, have these imprints changed the first lot?
Yes.
Yes. And that is the quality of neuroplasticity. So, in this case, it was a coin doing it, but in real life, what you're hearing and what you're thinking has the same effect as the coin. Do you get that?
Yeah.
So can you see your thoughts, what you think about, what you say, what you hear are very, very, very important. Yeah? And the wonderful thing is that new nerves can grow at any age of your life, not just as a baby, not just as a teenager when you're at school, but anything where you do something different. So you could be in your 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, and if you decide to take up golf, because you've never played golf, you'll develop new brain cells. If you decide to learn a new language, you can actually learn a new language at any age. Your brain is entirely capable, and it'll grow new nerves to hold all of that in. So the great news is that even if your brain has been damaged by accidents, by traumas, by drugs, it can be rewired, restored. I was talking to a gentleman earlier who had terrible trauma after an accident. And he was told by the doctors, you'd never walk, don't even bother. And the guy is sitting right there. Because he decided that he was going to go for it. And he did it one step at a time. So is that good news for you or not? So I want you to keep your Play-Doh always by your bed. If you are one who has got some depressive type of thinking, keep that near you to remind you, I can change my brain, and I'm jolly well going to. Okay? So, here are some more tips of how to help depression. So do you remember I showed you that cycle earlier, and worry was a big factor. Because it's been shown that a big factor in depression is anxiety, i.e. worrying. And the wonderful thing is that science has now found that this whole area of meditation, which I know some of you might think, oh my goodness, meditation, that sounds like New Age, it's from the East. Well, the thing is that people of other religions have taken this ability of the brain to rewire itself by meditation, and they've taken it into their religion. But it's just a principle of the brain. And God has been talking about meditation since the beginning of the Bible. And if you even go to Joshua, it talks about meditation. And it's there throughout the Bible, which we can show you later. But ironic as it may seem, the depressed brain can come out of depression by meditation, by learning to keep still, because what you're doing is, as your body's learning to keep still, is telling your brain to stop the circle of the emotional thoughts and the worries, okay? And the other wonderful thing that science is showing is that, do you remember I said earlier that when you have depression, your brain actually shrinks? Well, they've done brain scans to show that in one case, people meditated every day for 15 minutes, for 8 weeks. They scanned their brains before and after and found that in every one of them, the brain had grown in size in a very important part of the brain, which is that front part where you make decisions, where you're calm, where you're able to make wise decisions and wise judgments. So that's great hope for all of us, for any of you who have depression. And I thought today is the great time for you to learn, okay? Because I'm not going to send you away to just say, well, go and look up you know, an online or go to a course, because unfortunately what's happened is that everyone's jumped onto the bandwagon of meditation and it's become very expensive. So there are expensive courses that run. You can go online and people are charging you for it. But if you are interested, I can send you a link to free podcasts where you can learn to meditate like I'm going to show you in a minute. But we're just going to practice right now. So put down your pen and paper. Put down your plasticine. Right, so I want you to just kind of sit in a relaxed position. So ideally not crossed legs. Just sit back in your chair, hands on your legs. Close your eyes, because this will help you. Just going to do this for a few minutes, okay? Now, first of all, I just want you to take a deep breath in through your nose and out through your nose as well. And the reason we do that through the nose is because breathing in and out through the nose is actually slowing your body down. So breathe in to a count of three and breathe out to a count of five. Just do that a few times. Now, I want you to just, in your state with your eyes closed, I just want you to pay attention to your feet, to your toes. What are they doing? Are the toes kind of curled together? Are they touching the floor? Are they not touching the floor? Doesn't matter really. Are you just aware of them? Notice any sensation in them? Is there tightness? Is there pain? Is there softness? Whatever is there, just notice it. And as you take your next breath in, try and make that breath go all the way down to your toes, as if it's filling all your body, through your legs to your toes. And keep breathing in to a count of three, out to a count of five. Now I want you to notice your lower legs. Do they feel uncomfortable or comfortable? Is there any pain? Is there no pain? It doesn't matter. Just notice it. And then get back to your breathing. Breathe in for three. Breathe out for five. Now let's see if we can do something different. Now try breathing in for seven. A count of seven, so you're really slowing your breathing down. Making it slow and steady. In for seven and out for 11. So really slow it down. It doesn't matter if you don't get there straight away. In for seven, out for 11. just enjoy that for a few moments more. Okay, so we're now going to come out of that. When you're ready, you can open your eyes. How do you feel? You know, if you do that every day and you do it for 15 minutes, you will not only feel younger, you'll look younger. Do you know that? It's been proven by studies. But what's the biggest problem people have? It's doing it. Because by nature, we are creatures who try to stick to what we normally like to do. And any kind of change is difficult. But if, I'll challenge you, if you prepare to do that for a few weeks, and if you have depression or anxiety, things are going to start to change. Not only will your brain grow, but your whole worrying cycle will start to settle, will decrease, decrease, decrease. This type of meditation, which is called mindfulness meditation, because you're being mindful, all it means is you're being mindful of something other than your thoughts. Did you notice that when you were thinking about your foot, your toe, and your leg, in those few moments, were you thinking about anything else to do with life and your worries, and your path? Because you focused your attention away on other stuff, to your foot. But that type of meditation, mindfulness meditation, has been proven to be as effective for preventing recurrent depression as medication. As effective. So it's a great tool to use if you are one who feels like, I want to come off medication. Well, start doing this and your doctor will eventually say, hey, something's happened. You're getting better. Let's take you off. Right. So just a few more things to teach you today. I want to just talk about what psychologists now believe that every human being needs for living a balanced life, which can actually prevent depression. Okay? The first is they need security. So this is to help you, but help others. Or maybe if you look after people, if you're a connect group leader, if you're a pastor, if you're in a role, in a parent, this is to help you. Everyone needs security, a sense of feeling safe without experiencing excessive fear. So where might we not feel secure? If you're being abused, if you're being bullied, if you're on a war zone. All makes sense, isn't it? Another thing we need is what we call autonomy, or a sense of control in our lives, that we are able to know what's happening around us. So when can that go wrong? Again, when you're being abused or bullied, or you've had any form of trauma or tragedy that's happened to you, or you've been mugged. Any of those things can violate that, and that needs to be resolved. Also, another need is attention. Not just giving attention, but receiving attention. Do you know that? We all need some attention. So you know when you hear the phrase, oh, she's just an attention seeker, it's negative, isn't it? But actually, we all need it to some point to have a sense of being validated, to feel like we've been heard, that we've been appreciated, and that's a need for our soul. But not only do we receive attention, we need to give attention to people. And actually giving attention is good for your soul. Sound wonderful? Another need is an emotional connection to others, just through friendship, intimacy. And people who struggle with this are people who have somehow withdrawn from life, people who, because they're single perhaps and not married, think nobody's interested in me, you know, I'm not good looking, and they withdraw from life. That can lead to depression. Or sometimes people just don't have social skills. I don't know how many of you, when you walked into this room today, thought, oh, This is a group of people in this room. I'm going to have to talk to someone. But do you know what? Most people feel like that, if not everyone. There are a few extroverts, I know, like my husband, who loves people, and he just is very, you know, finds it very easy to talk to people. But I'm a bit on the shy side, so that's quite a normal thing, to be a bit apprehensive. But it can go to an extreme where you actually avoid people because you don't know how to handle talking to people. And that's just social skills, which again, a good therapist can teach you. And as part of the mesh, why is emotional connection so good for us? Because there's something about being together that feeds your soul. Even things like eating together, we're all going to be having lunch in a short while, but the whole point of lunch is not that you grab it and you go and sit in your car and just eat on your own. It's not to just feed your belly. There's something about sitting and eating together. Doing this with your family at home, switch off the TV and eat as a family around the table. It's actually very good for your well-being and releases lots of serotonin. And this is also involves laughter. I know many depressed people who say, I just don't laugh. I can't laugh. But some therapists have told me that when they've had those situations, they've sat that person down, made them shut their eyes and said to them, think back now to the last time when you roared with laughter. And they've sat maybe for a few minutes, and without fail, sooner or later, this mouth, curls, they start to smile, and then they actually start laughing, because all they had to do was remember something in the past. Do you remember what I said? Whatever you remember, your brain feels like it's now. So that's a great antidote for depression. Spend some time thinking about happy things and make yourself laugh. It's actually a very good medicine. Another emotional need is a connection to a wider community, being part of something larger than ourselves. And that's why church is a great place to do that, connect groups, and that's why book clubs and unions and all these things are great places, because all human beings need to belong somewhere. Another thing we all need is also privacy. Time out, space to reflect. And that's when you think about life and you just develop a sense of gratitude. You think, yeah, I'm on this journey, I'm going to enjoy this journey. That's the time when you do that. Even Jesus had time out, didn't he?
Yes.
If you notice that, when you read the Bible, it's important for the soul. And you may have 10 children and you may think, I'll never get time out. But I think that it was, correct me if I'm wrong, but John Wesley's wife,
yes,
who had all her children around her, and in those days women wore very long skirts, and she said from time to time, or it seems from time to time, she would take that skirt, wrap, put it over her head, and she'd be like, this is my quiet time. So however you do it, doesn't matter, but you need to do it. Another need is a sense of status, in a good sense, not being prideful and think I'm better than anybody, but just knowing that we have a valued place in the social group to which we belong. Yeah, so a group like this, or a committee, or some other group like that, if you feel like you're valued, it's good for you. Another thing we all need is a sense of competence and achievement. And again, with depression, people often say, oh, I've done nothing with my life, I've wasted my life. And a good therapist will say, well, hang on a minute. Did you pass your driving test? Yeah, I did. Well, that's an achievement. Did you ever pass any exam? Did you do grade one recorder? Yeah, I did. Well, that's an achievement. So you can think of, you can sit and you can find out things that you've done and achieved and feel good about that. And that we all need that. And we also all need a sense of meaning, which only can come when you're mentally and physically stretched, they say. So if you need to do things that are stretching you all the time. So coming here today, you're being stretched, aren't you? But just coming here today is very good for you, because you're learning new things. You're putting a demand on this brain that God has created in you. And another thing that will help you as part of meaning is actually serving others. Do you know that? And the ladies who came to women's conference 2 weeks ago will remember this. But there was a study done about 20 years ago where they studied patients with MS, multiple sclerosis. They took a group of them and divided them up into two groups, A and B. And they said, okay, we want people in group A to regularly phone group B and provide support. How are you? You know, how are things? Any help? What can I do? Let's just talk about the day. And they tracked them for 3 years. Can you guess which group did better after 3 years? Was it the group who gave the support or the group who received the support? The givers. The givers noticed a profound improvement in mood, depression, and self-worth. In fact, the doctors said that they were blossoming. And they said this, that helping other people transformed their experience of MS from something where they were a victim to something where they were a positive force in the world. So never look down on serving. So a church is a great place to serve. They were fantastic, a fantastic guy at the car park and the hose in the red shirt, people doing all the lunches, serving teas and coffee. The guy at the media desk, Jonathan, serving is actually benefiting them. Do you know that? So think about what can you do to serve, help other people. And just finally, in this whole area, just being thinking that you have a purpose, a destiny in life, thinking that you're part of some bigger picture. So this is psychologists saying this, not just church leaders, but finding or believing that you're part of something bigger is very important for your soul. And there have been lots of studies that show that people who are active religiously, doesn't matter what type of church they go to, but actually that they go to church and they're part of a group, have better mental health and better recovery from mental health issues than those who don't. Isn't that amazing? That's because, so all those things that I've mentioned just now cause your brain to grow, rewire, take on sort of new changes. But here are a few more things just to tell you of things that can change your brain, cause more chemicals to be released, health, good chemicals, and rewire your brain. One of them is actually your diet. Do you know that? It's been proven that a Mediterranean type of diet, do you all know what I mean by that?
Yeah.
Well, you can Google it. But basically, it's healthy diet with good oils, nuts, grains, fish, all those sort of things has been found to release more serotonin, but especially omega-3. Omega-3 is found in oily fish, and it's been shown, proven, that a brain deficient in omega is a brain that's not good at handling stress. So that's something to think about. You can just buy omega-3 supplements from Boots or wherever and start right away. Another thing that's bad for you, which you can change, is watching lots of TV and doing lots of computer games. Again, science has proved that actually degenerates your brain. Kills off the good stuff. So limit it and do something else instead. Can you guess what I'm going to suggest that you do instead? Exercise. And you might think, oh, no, yeah, I heard all about exercise. I don't like exercise. But do you know what? It's, again, science is showing that exercise lifts your mood because it increases blood flow to the brain and makes you release more serotonin and other chemicals. And they actually did a study in elderly people who were unresponsive to antidepressants. Because, you know, and with elderly people, it's a whole new category. You've got to be careful what you give them because of side effects, but many of them are not responsive. But they did a study, and they just sent them for twice a week exercise. Not every day, not twice a day, twice a week. And they found that their depression was significantly reduced after a few weeks. Now, one thing I will just say right now that's not good in terms of exercise for people who are depressed or anxious is long distance running or just running. Do you know why? Can you guess why? Because, exactly. What those people tend to do is as they are running along, pounding, their brain goes off into this world of, oh my goodness, why did I do this? Oh no, what about all these problems? I need to do that, I need to do this. Your brain is busy worrying while the body's running. So they're both cancelling each other out. So that's not a good thing to do. Well, what is good is something that you know naturally gives you pleasure, e.g. walking is a great exercise for releasing serotonin. But even better, walking with a friend and have an aim at the end of it, we're going to go to the pub. And I, so, as we come to the end of this session, I just want to say to you, just to tell you, do not anymore think, if you have depression, my brain is damaged, that's the end of it, I'm condemned to a life of medication and therapy. Do those things to help you cope now, but think of how can you rewire your brain. So start to think about meditation, start to think about your diet, start to think about exercise. Because of the wonderful quality God has put in all of our brains to what? Rewire itself, renew itself.